Captain James Tiberius Kirk was legendary for his captaincy of the USS Enterprise. During the halcyon era of we come in peace, shoot to kill, that was Starfleet's modus operandi in those early days. But the Enterprise was not the first Federation starship he was assigned to. Let's take a look at another one then, shall we? Welcome to Trek Central, lords, ladies, and sovereigns. I am your host, Lieutenant Adam. In this starship breakdown, we'll be looking at the somewhat famous USS Farragut, the first one, because there's been a lot. This is the ship mentioned in the original series as a ship that Kirk first served on before his time on the Enterprise. For a ship which has had a very famous Starfleet officer serve aboard her, I would say that makes her very worthy of being looked at. But before we warp into this video, if you want to keep up to date on all the latest Star Trek news, lore, and more, then make sure you hit that subscribe button to never miss a video from the team here at Trek Central, and don't forget to follow us on our social media for daily updates on the Star Trek universe, and even join the community Discord server if you like. I also should remind you that there are indeed spoilers ahead for Star Trek Strange New Worlds Season 1. If you've not watched that series yet, be warned, there will be mentions to it in this video. Anyway, engage! The Farragut was in service to the Starfleet of the United Federation of Planets from at least 2247 as an as-yet unnamed class of starship. At the time of writing and recording, we can refer to it as a Farragut-type starship. However, it appears that the Farragut is in fact a Surya-class. Delving way back into the dim and distant past of the D&D-inspired Star Trek role-playing game on this one. As for what it actually is in canon, however, that is unknown at this point. The ship had your usual Starfleet ship layout, you know, the saucer section, but no secondary hull. Oh, well, at least it had two warp nacelles, as was standard, but those came attached via pylons to the underside of the saucer. How these nacelles attached to the ship was weird in itself, as the pylons curved inward, underneath the saucer, instead of straight or curving outwards like most Federation ships tended to do. The result was that the Farragut had an interesting profile, as from above, the majority of the nacelles were actually hidden by that massive saucer section of its. These nacelles were similar in configuration to that of the Constitution class, which I'll bet most of you know, is not really a surprise. Constitution parts have often been seen used in other classes many times, such as the USS Peregrine Sombra class, where these nacelles could actually be Constitution class nacelles too. Continuing the theme of mass reused components, you can very clearly see that the Farragut's saucer section was very similar to that of the Archer, with a standard circular saucer, but the deflector dish, in the case of the Farragut, was attached to the underside of the hull, though what differentiates this deflector from that of the Archer is that it actually looks like the Farragut has an external sensor dish attached to the front. The topside of the Farragut saucer was also a bit weird, with your conventional bridge module in the center, but in front of this bridge module is a curved row of windows. Whether this section was similar to the mess hall of the Enterprise, which had curved windows on the saucer, or some other room requiring such massive windows on the saucer section, is not really known. The actual only interior of the Farragut we've seen so far is that of its bridge, and that's just your standard Federation Starship bridge nicked directly from the Starfleet 2260's design starter pack. The bridge is almost identical to that of the Enterprise, and considering, again, the reuse of Constitution-class components, the bridge module could also just be a Constitution-class bridge module slammed in this class. As with all Federation starships at the time, the Farragut would come equipped with an offensive array consisting mainly of photon torpedoes and a centrally forward-located phaser system. Defensive systems primarily focused around the deflector shields, and the propulsion system was a warp drive, using matter-antimatter reactions to allow the vessel to achieve faster-than-light speeds. Impulse engines were also located in the usual place at the rear of the saucer section, with two reactors by the looks of things. But what's really bizarre about it is that it didn't appear to have a shuttle bay. Now don't come at me, I'm fully aware that the Miranda class has a shuttle bay, but lest I remind you, that ship's engineering section was literally smashed onto the back of the saucer as if sculpted by poorly applied Play-Doh. So don't start with that nonsense. Presumably, it relies simply on its transporter systems for transportation on and off the ship, as well as docking systems whenever it goes into a dry dock facility. However, in the structure which houses the deflector dish, it does look like there may be a shuttle bay maybe there, but due to its size, it probably couldn't contain too many shuttles at one time. A shuttle bay could be located there, but honestly, I feel like between the two impulse engines at the back would be a more logical place for a shuttle bay to be located. And yes, I'm fully aware that I just contradicted myself with the Miranda class there. Whoop-de-doo, Basil. Perhaps more worthy of a less sarcastic whoop-de-doo is the fact that the Farragut still has a crew capacity of 200 people. Not bad, considering it doesn't have a secondary hull. By the year 2254, the Farragut was under the command of Captain Stephen Garavik, with his crew including the young James T. Kirk. Under Garavik's command, the Farragut would go on many missions, of contacting numerous races and visiting many planets, you know, your standard I'm famous resume. One of these planets included the planet Nural. Nural was a planet in its version of the Bronze Age, so protected by General Order 1 of Starfleet, which would later be called the Prime Directive, much to the chagrin of Christopher Pike. The Prime Directive, of course, for the benefit of anybody who's been living under a galaxy-sized rock for the last 60 years, referring to Starfleet's policy of non-interference with non-warp-capable civilizations. However, even with General Order 1, you know Starfleet walked a tightrope against these kind of regulation issues, going on undercover missions to such civilizations, such as what happened on Nural, where James T. Kirk would visit the planet on an undercover cultural survey and accidentally become friends with one of the groups of people that lived on the planet, who he would then reconnect with during his captaincy of the Enterprise when Nural became a proxy battleground between the Federation and Klingon Empire. Whoops, there goes General Order 1. Not for the last time, either. The only other canon thing we know about the Farragut is that in the year 2257, probably after the Klingon Federation War, it would come into contact with a Dicheronium cloud creature while exploring the planet of Tycho IV. This creature would then attack the ship and cause the deaths of 200 officers aboard, including Captain Garavik, but not including Kirk, in what, in my opinion, is the most obvious case of plot armor ever devised. Lieutenant Kirk would blame himself for these deaths, due to him being in the phaser control room at the time and feeling too slow to fire on the creature. However, the executive officer of the ship, who survived the encounter as well, would disagree, and stated that Lieutenant Kirk is a fine young officer who performed with uncommon bravery. Sorry. Kirk would find out, finally, under his own captaincy, upon meeting the creature again, that phaser fire did not even affect it, thereby causing his feelings of innate and total responsibility for the death of his crewmates to suddenly go poof. A ship of this class, which could have been the Farragut, was actually seen in the first episode of Strange New Worlds as well, weirdly also titled Strange New Worlds, where it could be seen in dry dock in an adjacent berth to the Enterprise. The next canonical time we would see the Farragut, though, would actually be in an alternate timeline, where Pike had managed to avoid his fate of being incapacitated after that training mission as fleet captain that we all know so well. Pike would make sure none of the cadets or himself were anywhere near the incident, altering time and fate, which allowed him to stay on as captain of the Enterprise, when in the Prime Universe, it would be Kirk who becomes captain. Because of this change in the timeline, in the year 2266, a cloak-enabled Romulan vessel would destroy multiple Federation outposts along the Federation-Romulan neutral zone, testing out their new weapon and the capabilities of their enemy. Pike and the Enterprise would gain the assistance of the USS Farragut, captained by Captain James T. Kirk, with First Officer Commander Lan Noonien Singh. I love her. The Farragut and the Enterprise would try a pincer maneuver to trap the cloaked Romulan vessel after being able to identify its position. However, this trap would be their undoing, as the Romulan vessel would not be anywhere near where it was predicted to be, taking the Enterprise and the Farragut completely by surprise and launching an attack run on the Farragut, crippling and ultimately destroying it. This alternate reality would lead to a war between the Federation and the Romulan people, which would last for decades to come, until a now Admiral Pike would make a deal with the Klingon monks of Boreth to go back in time and make sure that the past Chris Pike would not make the same decisions he did, accept his fate, and step down as captain of the Enterprise, allowing James T. Kirk to take his place, who would then go on to captain the USS Farragut in the Prime timeline after Kirk assumes command of the Enterprise is unknown. But we could see maybe a Captain Larnunian Sink taking captaincy of the vessel if Kirk's not there. Maybe. That would be cool. At least to me. Shut up, I can dream. Even after this 23rd century Farragut, though, the legacy of the name would not go away. There were numerous other ships taking its name. The USS Farragut NCC 60597, which was a Nebula-class, would be seen in Star Trek Generations, recovering the crew of the Enterprise D after it crashed on the surface of Viridian 3, following the battle with the Dura sisters on their crappy old bird of prey. That very same Farragut would then assist some colonists during the Federation-Klingon War 2 years later in 2373, but the ship would be attacked en route and destroyed near the Limbata cluster. After this loss, a new USS Farragut would be commissioned, an Excelsior-class starship this time, which would be stationed at Deep Space Nine on multiple occasions during the Dominion War. And finally, we have the Kelvin timeline USS Farragut. Yes, I know, it's the Kelvin universe, which would be one of the vessels assigned to the fleet sent to investigate the disturbance on Vulcan. This would turn out to be Nero, of course, and the Narada, which would go on to not only destroy the fleet, the Farragut included, but also Vulcan itself. All in all, in my opinion anyway, it's just a terrible idea to name your ship Farragut if you want it to have any kind of longevity. I mean, we've got Dicheronium cloud monsters, Romulan birds of prey, Klingons, or angry Romulan miners with doomsday machines and a grudge against an entire planet. It's just not a good idea to serve aboard anything named Farragut, alright? As I've mentioned before, its first appearance in this incarnation was on Strange New Worlds, Quality of Mercy, but it has been mentioned since the original series episode, Obsessions, almost 55 years prior. Who designed the ship is sadly unknown nowadays, though we do know that Ryan Denning, a ship designer who has been with Trek since the beginning of Discovery, has worked on Strange New Worlds, so it's likely that the newest version of the Farragut we've seen on our screens today was designed by him. I'm sure there is more info on the Farragut, its designer, concept artist, and everything else will be revealed in due time, and if you're interested in this aspect of the Farragut and bringing the ship to life, make sure to follow us on our social media where we will share such information as soon as we have it. But what did you think of the Farragut and its unique-looking design, yet still Starfleet standard, in a way? Let us know in the comments below. And if you want us to look at any other ships seen in Strange New Worlds, Romulan fleets, Gorn ships, any of them really, I'm pretty sure there's a warp-powered washing machine out there somewhere, then let us know, because as always, if you're talking about Star Trek, we'd love to hear about it. And again, if you want to keep up to date with all the latest Star Trek news, lore, and more, then make sure you hit that subscribe button. Never miss a video from the team here at Trek Central. You can also follow us on social media or join our community Discord server. For now, though, I've been Lieutenant Adam. Thanks for watching. And we'll see you next time. Live long and prosper, my friends.